Hi, the goal of this tutorial is to get key verifications to work in Node.js. Our focus today is going to be on the key verification example that you can find on our GitHub page, and we'll go through what all of these parameters mean and where you can find the value for them. So let's start off by copying the code into an existing file. And I'll also mention that for this to work, you need to install our package. I've already done it in this case, but I'll just show you how the procedure looks like. So we can copy it like this and paste it. And it'll take some time, and then that's done. We've installed it. So there are four parameters. If we just look at this example, there are four parameters that you need to replace. The first is the RSA public key. The second is the access token. And then there's also the product ID and the license key string. There's one more parameter, machine code, which we will discuss towards the end of the video. So let's start off with the RSA public key. If you click on this link here, you'll be redirected to the key verification page, and then you can click here. You get to the quick start guide. And if you scroll down a bit, you see the RSA public key. It's important to copy it as it is and make sure there are no typos and no extra white spaces. And that's done. To get the access token, you could use the one that's here, but I would like to show you how you can create your own access token, which is recommended when you run the applications in production. So you can click on your username, access tokens, create new access token. We give it activate permission. Let's call it test. Scroll down a bit. There's one more thing that you can set, and it's the restriction on the product that may use this access token. I will just set it to any product, but in production, you might want to consider to restrict it to a specific product. Create. Now we have the access token. Go back. Insert it here. And there are two more things. The product ID and the license key string. So the product ID you can find on the product page. If we go back, I already have some products that I created earlier. So for an existing product, you just go and retrieve the value that's this here. I'd also like to show you how you can do it with an with a new product. So you can go back to the main page, create a new product. Let's call it test project 2. Keep the same or keep the values as they are. Create. Now that's done. So we have a new product ID. We can paste it in here. And then there was one more thing, the license key string. So to get it, we clicked on the create new key. We can keep the defaults, but I like to set feature 3 to true because then we can retrieve this value in the code. You can click on create. Now copy the key and then replace it. There's the machine code field, but we'll keep it unchanged for the time being. So that's done. Now let's try running this code. Hopefully we've changed all the parameters. Yes. So now it printed the creation date in as a Unix timestamp. Since we set the feature 3 flag to true, we can also retrieve this value in the code. So let's type license feature 3. And to make it more pedagogical, we'll do like this. And this is supposed to be true. Yes, so feature 3 is true, and that's what we expected because that's what we set it to be when we issued license. So this is everything that you need to get that particular key verification example to work. Just to recap, the RSA public key, the access token, the product ID, and the license key. These were the only parameters that you need to change to get this to work. As I said, there's also the machine code parameter that that is being sent to the activate method. And what it does is that it identifies an end user. So for example, in this case, we are identifying this particular device as a unique end user. So for example, if you would like to have a constraint on how many users can use a license simultaneously, then you would like to pass in this machine code field. That's why it's necessary. So by default, it's not being tracked, but for example, if I go back and click on the license key and then I scroll down and then set this to, let's say 5 as an example, and then if I perform the activation again, like this, so if we go to, there's a yellow button next to the license key, if we can click on that, we see that now there is one device that has activated that license. There are two different licensing models that you can use. There's the node locking, where activations are permanent, and there's also the floating license model, where you can set a constraint on how many users you can have concurrently. So for example, you might have clients who have it installed on your application, installed on maybe like 100 computers, but then you could have a constraint that they can only use it on 10 of them simultaneously. That way, it's similar. You can think of it as a way for each of the computers to lease a license for a specific period of time. So for that to work, we had to set the maximum number of machines to a value greater than 0. There's one more method that you can use, which is not part of the example, but that is, so if we check here, so helpers get machine code, there is another method you can use called helpers is on write machine. We pass in the license key or the license object and we keep it like this. So there's no need to, on some of them is the case, there are different methods to compute machine code, but in Node.js, it's just one. So if we run it, we can type is on correct machine. Let's see if this will work. Is on the correct machine true? So we're on the correct machine. There is one thing that might be a bit confusing, and that is if we wouldn't have set the, so when we created the license, let's create a new license, but then we don't set the value for the maximum number of machines. So we use this newly created license. If we go back, and use this one instead. If we run the code, you can see the result here is that it's false. So it's, again, very important that whenever you use the isOnWrite machine method to check for example, when you have a constraint on how many users can use the license simultaneously, it's very important that you set the maximum number of machines to a value greater than 0. Otherwise, if we, for example, if we look at this license, the new one, you can see that the our device hasn't been activated. So to recap, we covered all of the necessary parameters, the RSA public key, access token, product ID, and the license key string that need to be changed. And we also talked about the machine code and that there are different ways of computing machine code, depending on how you would like to define end users. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us. Thank you.